And he said, no, I was the Mariel Boatlift first servo. So he was actually picked up and brought over safely. He's an amazing friend, as you all know, because he's here today. He's a great husband and a wonderful, proud father. He's got a daughter that looks like his sixth grandchild, not because he looks old, because she looks so young. And she has five children. They are wonderful members of our community. They give back in ways that are so special, because a lot of people give time, a few less people give money, and even less people create ever-increasing opportunities. And that's what Manny has always done, because he has seen Miami in ways that few of us can see it, not unlike our boss and partner, Alicia Rivera Sr., who came to a very small town and saw an amazing global city. So, Mr. Medina, our friend, please come up with me.
Thank you very much. Wow, how time passes, isn't it? It is such a great honor for me personally to be here today. I mean, when Alicia called me, I mean, I know her well enough to know that I was the 19th call. she scraped the bottom of the barrel. I know that, but I'm not going to say no. I have to do it for Alicia. So it's a real, for me personally, this is an emotional day because I have such a long history. They've been such a great part of my life, and one of the most incredible transactions I've ever done in my entire life, it was because of Alicia. So anyway, so all of that just makes this day particularly special. So what I'm always telling is, you know, I'll speak to you for a few minutes, and then Alicia and I are going to sit here and have a chat. So when we're thinking about what I was going to talk to you about, we recently founded a new company called Sixtera Technology. You may have read about it. It's a $2.8 billion startup. So if you can imagine that. And we launched the company in May last year. What the company does is it provides secure IT infrastructure for large enterprises and government agencies. So basically, big in cybersecurity, analytics, and all modern stuff that we're all so worried about, right? So the company's big. We have about 1,300 employees. We have operations around the world. And the company's coming together. So last week, we had our first ever annual sales conference, much like what you're doing today, only for the sales team. We had our annual support. We had about 233 people in Dallas, come from all over the world, where operations are. And of course, I spoke to them. And when I spoke to them, I said to them, the first thing is, what are you doing here? Why are you here? Why are you here today? Right? Why do you think I brought you here to pay this enormous amount of money to be here? So I thought today I would do the same thing because it's very relevant to what Alicia and Veronica and Alicia Seymour are doing. Right? So what are you doing here today? Why are you here today? You're here because you want to make money. At the end of the day, forget about everything else. All this stuff, you're here because you know who wants you to make a lot of money? Alicia Seymour and Veronica. They want you to make more money than you ever, that you're so grossly out with money that you're going to say, I don't know what to do, right? And that's why we're here today, right? So in order to do that, and salespeople are very much like entrepreneurs, right? And it's funny because I started my career as a CPA with Cashflow. I am the farthest removed person from an accounting career that you've ever seen. I did it as a calculator decision. My DNA is sales. I've been selling all my life. I've sold encyclopedias, I've sold magazine subscriptions, I've sold, most of you remember the Hope Chest. Didn't make a lot of money, but it was great for my romantic life. So I've sold everything. It's my DNA, it's what I love to do. Nothing turns me on more than bringing a deal home, right? And basically, as I thought about my life, and I speak particularly to MBA, all graduates, and I have a kind of a duty of paying it forward. When I speak to them, the first thing also is, why did you get this degree? Because they all want to make money as well. At the end of the day, yeah, they like to have a life that is fulfilling, all this stuff, but really they want to make money as well. And they all ask me, the first thing they ask me is, what's the secret? Tell me the secret. And the first thing I tell them is, let me disappoint you. There is no secret to success. it's, and I did compare it to the weight loss industry. There are billions of dollars spent every year in the weight loss industry, right? What's the secret to losing weight? Eat less, exercise more. Period. There's no secret. Why don't people do it? Because it's really hard, right, to be able to do it. But so therefore, but as I've kind of gone through my career, there are certain things that have helped me get to where I am today. And you know, one of the things that people ask me all the time is, what part does luck play in your success? Obviously, there's no question that luck plays a part. I mean, if I didn't have a courageous parents that would have put me and my sister on a boat when I was 13 years old, I wouldn't be here. That's luck. I had cousins, their parents didn't do the same thing. They were afraid of doing it, so that's luck, right? But let me tell you something that I found in my life. The harder that I work, the luckier that I get. There's no question, there's no turnaround about that, right? So basically, as I've looked at what has helped me, and as I look at you today, the number one thing that you're selling in your life today is not real estate, it's not condominiums, project, it's your trust, right? So the way I tell it is, think of yourself as a brand. The Cervera brand is grown all these years. Why? Because you trust it. If you didn't trust it, people wouldn't be buying from the Cervera brand, right? So now you individually are a brand. And when you look at yourself as a brand, that trust has to go right into you, right? So what helps create that trust? Of course, you have to be reliable, you know, things like being on time, things that are really stupid because you create a reputation. When you create that reputation. So when as I've looked at it, what is the number one thing? There are certain principles that have helped me a lot. And the number one thing that has helped me a lot is my attitude. It is the toughest, most difficult thing to do, is to have a positive attitude all the time. It is really hard to get up in the morning and something happened to you. And you can train yourself to do it. I do it even in the worst of situations. And I found that it's tremendously helpful, because people like to coalesce and congregate around people that have a positive attitude. Think about it yourself. You have friends. I'm sure you have friends that are drama queens and drama kings. They can't wait to give you a bad piece of news, right? I mean, I have one like that. I love her dearly, but when she calls me, oh my God, you know, I just let her go to voicemail, right? So basically, who do you want to be around? You want to be around people that are positive, that make you feel good. So instead of you, if something happens to you, that doesn't mean you need to go celebrate and get a speeding ticket, but you know, it's not the end of the world, right? And you come in and that, so that attitude is contagious. It happens. You know, it's like, think about, you gotta get your shout back, right? In that attitude. I mean, you know what I mean by your shout back? You know how little kids, you're always telling, shout, you're too loud. You know how they're always high? And that's that positive energy that comes out of you, right? And you can do it. You can do it in a way that is actually beneficial to you and to people around you, right? And the one thing that I guarantee you, 100%, is that bad things are gonna happen to you. Your boyfriend is gonna leave you, your girlfriend is gonna cheat on you, whatever. Then you're gonna go back home, you're gonna get sick. I guarantee you that, because without that, you cannot have the good. It's the yin and the yang. It is impossible for you to have the good without the bad. It just happens, right? So basically, there are certain Eastern cultures that when something bad happens, they actually celebrate, because it's gonna be followed by something good. As I've looked at my life, that's exactly what happens. When something you think about it in your own life, when something really happens bad to you, most of the time, if not all the time, as time goes by, you would have said, that's the best thing that happened to me. As a perfect example, I will tell you, as part of my history, is I came from Cuba, fast forward, started my career, and my career wasn't like this, but it was pretty quick. Over the first 10 years, I was being written up, I was a front page of a newspaper, you know, I had all these great projects, you know, and I beginning to believe my own propaganda, which is really a bad idea. And I'm saying, man, I'm really good, right? All of a sudden, life has its way of taking a 2x4 and putting it back in the head. Through no fault of mine, I started a project here, which made a tenant half of the building, and the company went bankrupt. The executives were indicted. I had nothing to do with it, but I was a developer. And my life crumbled. I went from a mansion in Star Island to a rented apartment to really hanging on by my teeth with the kids, etc. My life totally crumbled. And I had a very good friend of mine, actually a mentor, who has since passed away, Lebanese guy, who invited me to go, says, you know, you're not doing anything here. I was mired in litigation. There's just a lot. My life totally changed overnight without even knowing how it happened, right? I ended up in the Middle East, helping Kuwait being rebuilt. So I went from here to two guys and ended up being in the middle of the fires. The bodies had just been lifted. I literally was in Kuwait a few days after the liberation, and I ended up spending a lot of time in Kuwait helping liberate Kuwait. I mean, rebuild Kuwait. From there, Saudi Arabia. So all of a sudden, for a number of period of time, I was out of Miami, in a place where I couldn't have a beer, go to the movies. I didn't have a friend. We ended up creating an incredible business, and by the time that I sold the business, 3.5 years later, I had 2,700 men working in Kuwait, and we had in Saudi, and had all these incredible contracts. But here's what happened. That experience for me was the best thing that happened to me in my life for many reasons. First of all, I found myself. I've never experienced solitude, right? I've never been in a situation since I was a kid where all of a sudden I went from here to here. I was working 18 hours a day. I came home and the smoke was in my nostrils. And that whole hardship of working there was very, very refreshing for me. Also, something that happened is I've always liked technology, but I never really studied it. But there I had to fend for myself. There was no IT support. So I had to get into it and really got myself into technology. And the more I got into technology, the more I loved it. This would have never happened. Eventually, that led into the internet, which I became fascinated with when, you know, in the early 90s. And then I decided to shift in my career, went into technology. You heard recently, just a few years ago, that I sold the company that I trademarked for over $2 billion. Would have never happened. Had it not been for that tenant that defaulted, for that foreclosure, for me being in the Middle East, would have never happened. Now, I don't know what happened to me in real estate, right? And maybe whatever. But the point being is that every time that something bad is happening to me in my life, bar none, if you give it enough time, it happens. So that positive attitude and that energy is probably being the number one thing that has helped me the most. So I encourage you to practice it. It's just very, very difficult, right? Because, you know, puts on all the time, right? Another thing that I am passionate about is I'm passionate about learning and preparation. My team that works with me knows that I'm anal about preparation and learning. What I mean about learning is there's nothing worse. Now you have your positive attitude, you've got a real big shot client, you're gonna take him to lunch or dinner or her, and then all you do is try to sell him a condo the entire period, right? If you are a balanced person and if you learn about stuff, I love Jeopardy. I love useless information, right? Not everything, you know, war, crime, you know, whatever. I read the label in the cereal every morning, even though I know what it's going to say. I learn and actually capture all this stuff. And that, you know, it makes you, I'm not saying this in any kind of way and being arrogant, but it makes you interesting. You're able to talk to people about what's really going on in their lives. And that learning and then prepare. I will never, ever go to a meeting that I'm not prepared for. Today is so easy. I mean, Vinny was talking about how difficult it was in the old times. I mean, you had to go microfish and who is the person and then look for newspaper articles in the library. I mean, all this stuff, and we used to do it. Today, you can Google, you know, there's so many tools that you can use today. It is unconscionable. When somebody comes to my office and they find a meeting with me and they're not prepared, that meeting lasts 10 minutes. 10 minutes, I'm not rude. But I say, I'm sorry, but I don't have the time. Because the biggest and most precious commodity that I have today is time. All of us. It's your precious commodity. So you have to be prepared. And then it helps you. That preparation helps you pivot in the middle of the conversation. You know that person's personal interest. You know where it is there. And you know what he or she is feeling at that moment. So that learning and preparation is the second. There are many more, but the last one that I'll talk about this particular subject is something that you all know, also, like the positive attitude, is perseverance. And I'll tell you another story when it comes to that. And it really is tough to persevere. People talk about it, particularly in sales, right? Why don't people like to sell? Because you don't like to be rejected. You don't want somebody to say no, period. That's just human nature, right? So basically, the really great salespeople persevere. They don't take it personal, they persevere, right? So perseverance, the difficulty with perseverance is you don't know what is gonna happen. I had a professor of mine, I'll never forget this, one time, that said, look, here's the problem with persevering is that, think about it as a ladder that has thousands of steps, and it goes to no, you don't know where. There's no end to that ladder. And you know that in one of those steps, you're gonna succeed, right? But you don't know if it's step 20, step 40, or step 1,082. And then the first 20 steps you take with great interest, excitement. 20 to 40, and then you begin doubting yourself, and then you go there and you say, that last step, I'm not gonna take it because it's not gonna happen. The moment you say that, you're done, you're doomed. Start again, because that perseverance is the biggest tool. I'll tell you a story. When I shifted my business, one of the first big projects that we did is in Apple, the Americas. The building that is downtown Miami that all of you know is now the center of communication between Latin America, North America, and Europe. It's like the massively bigger than Miami International Airport, but it's transmitting bits, right, instead of people. So we built in Apple, the Americas. We're a public company. The building, although important, the important part was this exchange point. We were building a digital airport. Imagine, and the way the analogy that I used was, think about if you would have the opportunity of owning Miami International Airport in the 1920s, right? That was what we were doing. I believed in it so strong that I knew that eventually it was gonna be very, very valuable. What happened? The industry went to hell. The internet bubble burst. The telecommunications industry imploded. September 11th, all within a period of a year and a half. In the middle of that period, we were building the Apple of the Americas. We're a public company. For those of you who are from here, you remember it wasn't a matter of whether if we were going to file bankruptcy, it was a matter of when. We were literally hanging on by the skin of our teeth as a public company and really worrying Monday on how we're going to make Friday's payroll. But here's what happened. We believed in the project so much, and we believed that it was going to be so valuable that we said, you know what? I'm gonna go all in into this thing. This is when the story that I was telling you about Chris. And when I speak to young, because they all play Texas Hold'em, they all love poker, I said, you know what it is to go all in? I went all in, right? But it still wasn't enough. Because you know, you're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars at that point. Wall Street was out to lunch. My CFO and I would go and pitch anybody about money with that same passion. We would take, my arms are longer because I had a 40-pound laptop in one and a 40-pound projector in another one. We would be pitching the cab driver from LaGuardia to the city. We would give anybody who had credit cards for Max, and we were really fighting for survival because we believe very strongly that once we turn that corner, that we were going to make it. So anyways, as a matter of fact, I have a very funny story about this. So we get a meeting in New York with a banker that of a bank institution that no longer exists. It's one of the ones that went under in 08. And my CFO will vouch for this story. We go in, we set up before, we had the projector, et cetera. We had a pitch, you know, 30-minute pitch, and then the whole time, passion, you know, this is what it's gonna be, the next airport, blah, 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 blah. And we finish the story, and the guy didn't say a word. So I said, you have any questions? So he goes into his pocket, gives me an envelope. It was his resume. I said to Jose, let's go to plan B. So anyways, but this is all about perseverance, right? So we never gave up. I used to live for a long time at Fish Island. I loved living in Fish Island. At the time, because I put all the money in this, all that, I was probably the only person in Fish Island that was literally broke, right? But basically, a lot of people around me in Fish Island have a lot of money. And a friend of mine had turned me on to this guy that was from Connecticut and had the securities business, blah, blah, blah. And he said, look, he likes to do speculative stuff like this. You should talk. So I researched and had a Saturday afternoon, I saw him where he sat at the bar. So I sat there before he sat. He always had the same seat. So I did my whole preparation routine. The guy sits next to me and we're having a beer. Introduced myself and began talking about his business and security. You know, you can imagine, right? All this stuff's there. And then he asked me what I do. I run a publicly traded company, which I did. blah, blah, blah. And then he said, I said, what are you doing? Oh, you're secure. What a coincidence. We're in the middle of a capital raise. I said to the guy. He said, oh, yeah. What kind of capital? I said, no, it's a secondary publicly traded company. He said, oh, for what? And then I tell him about this Now the America's thing that we're building, et cetera, et cetera. This is Saturday. And then he says to me, where is it? I said, it's right here in downtown Miami, maybe next week. He says, no, where do we go now? Okay, this is Saturday, so here's what happened. Now I have a, my right-hand guy has been with me for 17 years, his name is Nelson Fonseca, young guy. And this is Saturday afternoon, and we were in such a skeletal crew because we had no money. And then they all had, we had spare orange shirts, which is what they wore at the knock, at the main center, to give to people to for it to look like if we were full. So I said to Nelson, I said to him, okay, I'll pick you up. So I we have a golf cart. In the golf cart, called Nelson, Nelson, we have a live one. This is let's go. So I'm going over there. And he said, how, give me some time. I said, get whoever in the floor, I don't care. Get that knot to look like it's there. So give me as much time as possible. I said, well, between the ferry, you know, tell me, maybe I'll miss the ferry on purpose. We get to the knack, and Nelson has done a good job as always. And I'm giving him the, you know, it's a complicated business to understand, but I'm taking him around, and I'm showing him around, and in the middle of it, just almost when I'm finished, before actually, he says, I've seen enough. I said, another one, okay, you know, and you said, don't worry, tomorrow will be a better day. And he said, how much is it that you're looking for? And I said, and we're looking for $90 million. And I said, $90 million is the secondary we're gonna go for. He said, I think we can do that. I love this idea. I love it. I think what you have here is great. And I said to him, okay. And he said, now I'm getting really turned on. He says to me, so I said, let me get really adventurous. He said, well, let me tell you something, Mr. Man. I actually have a lot of demand for this already. So if you're gonna be serious, you really have to put up, you know, something if you want me to wait for you. So he said, how much? He said, $5 million by next week. And he said, what if I send you seven? This is a true story. And I said, done. If you send me seven, I'll hold for you for 30 days. You have the exclusive and you have the first thing on the terrace. Long story short, 27 days later, we had $92 million in the bank.
Oh my
God. Right? The reason why I'm telling you this is because it's perseverance. You would never know if he was him or the next guy or the next guy, right? So anyways, those three topics, right? Attitude, get your shout back, you prepare endlessly, you persevere, and you're gonna make so much money that you're gonna be grossed out. So thank you very much.
Amazing.